surprise you to know that Ruth Bader Ginsburg, maybe the most notorious pioneer of women's rights in our lifetime, was a critic of Roe v. Wade?
Or would it surprise you to know that she's just one of many progressive thinkers to criticize Roe?
This might sound like a paradox, but there's a large contingent of people, very educated people, like judges and scholars, who simultaneously support a woman's right to choose to have an abortion while also believing that Roe was a poorly reasoned mess.
So grab your jackhammers. We're going to try to break down this confusing logical construction.
That was really bad.
Last week, the Supreme Court heard oral arguments in Dobbs v. Jackson, the Mississippi law that bans abortions at 15 weeks.
Based on what we've heard from oral arguments thus far, it seems like SCOTUS is poised to overturn Roe v. Wade, or at least significantly restructure it. So let's start with a very quick, very high-level background of abortion law in the United States.
In 1973, the court in Roe v. Wade found that the right to privacy gave women a fundamental right to have an abortion. In affording a constitutional protection for abortions, the court held that, prior to the point of fetal viability,
meaning the ability of the fetus to live outside the womb,
states could not fully outlaw abortions.
But once viability was reached, states could outlaw abortions. Basically, the court looked to balance the interests of the fetus against the pregnant mother's right to privacy.
Once the fetus becomes viable, its right to life outweighs the mother's right to privacy.
The decision in Roe was based on the idea that the Constitution grants a right to privacy, and that that right to privacy extends to a woman's right to have an abortion.
But there's one elephant-sized problem that must be addressed. The Constitution says absolutely nothing about privacy. As one commentator put it, the Constitution says just as much about quantum physics as it does about privacy.
Here's a look back at one of our prior videos where we explain how the right to privacy first came about. The idea that the Constitution includes a right to privacy first gained traction about 8 years before Roe, but in a different Supreme Court case.
In this case, the court explicitly acknowledged that the Constitution says nothing about a right to privacy, but still found that the right to privacy existed in the penumbras of the Constitution. Basically, the court argued that certain explicit constitutional rights created by implication certain other implicit rights. These implicit, aka penumbral rights, existed in the shadows of the enumerated rights.
So how did the court find a penumbral right to privacy? They read between the lines of the First Amendment, the Third Amendment, the Fourth Amendment, and the 14th Amendment. In reading these amendments together, the court inferred that a right to privacy was implied.
The right to privacy has gone on to serve as a constitutional basis, not just for the right to choose to have an abortion, but also for several other rights, including the right to possess and view adult pornography in your home, and the right for consenting men to engage in sexual intercourse with each other. That was like 2 months ago. Do I look younger there?
You look fine.
Okay, so many individuals have a hard time accepting the Supreme Court's rationale that this constitutional right to privacy, which doesn't actually explicitly exist in the Constitution, then goes on to protect a woman's right to have an abortion.
Let's look at a quote from Edward Lazarus, a famous lawyer, writer, and former clerk to Supreme Court Justice Harry Blackmun, who actually authored the Roe opinion. As a matter of constitutional interpretation and judicial method, Roe borders on the indefensible. I say this as someone utterly committed to the right to choose, and as someone who loved Roe's author like a grandfather. The problem, I believe, is that it has little connection to the constitutional right it purportedly interpreted.
And again, Lazarus is far from the only person who is pro-choice on the one hand, yet anti-Roe on the other. Another point of criticism for Roe is the viability standard.
After all, what does viability really mean? Neither Roe nor its progeny, Planned Parenthood v. Casey, actually provided any explicit standard for when viability occurs.
If we look to state statutes for clarification, viability has been described as occurring when, in the good faith medical judgment of a physician, on the particular facts of the case before that physician, there is a reasonable likelihood of the fetus's sustained survival outside the uterus without the application of extraordinary medical measures.
Crystal clear, right?
Not really. Many legal commentators argue that fetal viability presents an unworkable legal standard because determining viability is so nebulous and fact-specific.
Within the medical community, it's recognized that viability can be influenced by a multitude of factors, such as race, gender, whether the mother smokes, the medical technology available at the time, and even the altitude of where the mother lives.
Even more confusing, the entire concept of viability can be subjective. Different physicians can disagree as to when a specific fetus has progressed to the state of viability.
And as medical technology continues to evolve, how early might viability be reached? Will a fetus one day be able to survive outside the womb by week 15? As a final point of criticism, many argue that the Supreme Court overstepped its boundaries in even deciding Roe in the first place. As the argument goes, the true function of the Supreme Court is to interpret law, not to make it.
This idea goes back to the Constitution, which says that all legislative power in the government is vested squarely within Congress. In other words, Congress is the only part of the government that can make new laws or change existing laws. The Supreme Court's job is to interpret those laws and to ensure that they comply with the Constitution. Now, Roe certainly isn't the first or only time that the Supreme Court has been accused of legislating from the bench. It's a fairly common complaint.
But with Roe, many believe that the justices already had their own pre-existing beliefs about abortion, and that they went through some questionable legal maneuvers to arrive at what they wanted the law to be, not what the Constitution said it should be.
And this is kind of the crux of the whole issue. Those who support open access for abortions, yet also criticize Roe, they want a federal law passed by Congress, providing women with the right to an abortion that is passed by a democratically elected Congress rather than crafted by 9 presidentially appointed members of the Supreme Court, would offer a more sturdy and reliable foundation.
So with this information, what do you think about Roe?
Are you yourself a paradox?
Someone who is pro-choice but also thinks that Roe is a poorly reasoned mess?
Let us know in the comments.